Thank you for joining us for this first ever ICS Wayfinders Microsymposium. Our topic today is identity, imagination, and the other. So please, our first experiment with online video broadcasting, please be patient with the technical challenges we will undoubtedly encounter. ICS, the Institute for Christian Studies, is a graduate school of philosophy based in Toronto, Canada, and the Wayfinders is a new lifelong learning community nurtured by the ICS. You can follow us on Twitter at ICS Wayfinders, where we host a Twitter chat every Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday at noon Eastern Time. You can search for our chat with hashtag WayChat, that is hashtag WayChat. I am your host today. My name is Gideon Strauss. I am an associate professor in worldview studies at the Institute for Christian Studies, and our guests in this week's microsymposium are Ron Kuipers, Hayashi, and Jeffrey Ansloos. So Ron and Aya and Jeff, please tell us a little bit about yourselves.
Hi, I'm Ron Kuipers. I'm an associate professor of philosophy of religion at the Institute for Christian Studies in Toronto, and I also direct the Center for Philosophy, Religion, and Social Ethics at the Institute for Christian Studies. Did you want any more than that, Gideon, or is that good enough?
I think that's good for a start.
Okay.
Hi, everyone. My name is Aya Hayashi. I am a PhD candidate in musicology at the Graduate Center at the City University of New York, New York City. I specialize in the musics of science fiction fan communities. So on any given day, I am listening or analyzing folk music about Star Trek, punk rock about Harry Potter, or watching a whole stream of funny musicals on YouTube that are based around geeky topics.
Hello, everybody. My name is Jeffrey Ansloos. I'm an assistant professor of international mental health and trauma studies and the program director of global interdisciplinary studies at Lesley University in our Graduate School of Arts and Social Sciences. Actually, in the midst of transitioning to a new role at University of Victoria in the Faculty of Human and Social Development. What can I tell you? My scholarship is in the area of violence and First Nations youth, specifically looking at ethical intersections of imagination and nonviolence in current Canadian settler and Indigenous relations. So thanks for having me.
I think I'm going to go a little bit outside of what we've prearranged and ask each of you just a follow-up question about yourselves. So maybe, Ron, since you started out, can you take us back to the prehistoric era when you were working on your doctoral dissertation? Tell us about the topic and tell us what intrigued you about that topic.
Sorry, Gideon, you went a little garbled there for a second when you asked your question. So were you referring to today's topic and how we landed on it?
No, no? I want to hear about your PhD dissertation.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, so my PhD dissertation is called Critical Faith Toward a Renewed Understanding of Religious Life and Its Public Accountability. And the project really sort of evolved out of I'm one of those kind of scholars who goes to grad school to tackle their own existential questions. So growing up in the Christian Reformed Church in Canada and having some problems with aspects of that inheritance, but also recognizing a lot of value in it, mm-hmm. I used my scholarly work at the PhD level to tease out what it means to be a religious person today and what, in a pluralist society, what kind of levels of critical self-reflection do we need to meet in order to for our religious contributions to be, you know, welcomed and beneficial in public discourse. So, you know, there's within that, I had a chapter on Habermas, I had a chapter on John Locke, and a lot of folks in between. And, so that was published by Rodopi back in 2002 or 3 or something like that. But yeah, anyway, so that's that project in a nutshell.
Aya, Philk, why?
So I discovered Philk when I was a I'm actually still a Firefly fan. It was a very short-lived TV series in 2002 created by Joss Whedon. And I came across a song by this folk duo called Vixie and Tony that took the theme song from the TV show Firefly and added verses to it. And I was so intrigued by this pseudo-parodic practice that I started writing about it on all of my grad school applications. And they kept asking me about it, and I even sang some of the songs in my interviews. And then I just kept pursuing the topics, doing some social theory courses, getting interested in discourse analysis, and then in the process of doing field work on Filk and in the Filk communities around the U.S., I came across this thing called Wizard Rock. And so from there, I started to expand out my topic to do not only a history of music in science fiction fan communities, but also looking at how social media and different people from different generations approach the act of musicking. So, yeah.
Very interesting.
And Jeff, maybe talk a little bit about your own doctoral work.
Sure, yeah. I did my PhD in clinical psychology, and I've also done graduate work in theology. But my PhD dissertation focused on what is sort of emerging within much of Canadian academia as Indigenous perspectives in social science, specifically looking at Indigenous perspectives on nonviolence. And so my dissertation put into conversation a number of ethical perspectives that emerge within critical social science, certainly that of communitarian ethics, and looked at places of resonance and intersection with traditional Anishinaabe and Cree perspectives on nonviolence. Looked at the ways they mutually inform one another and also where they're dissonant. And then tried to look for ways in which this could inform how we might envision an Indigenous practice of nonviolence, in particular within the current Canadian criminal justice system and its work with First Nations youth, which are disproportionately represented within incarceration rates. So that's sort of a number of things that it touches upon, but yeah.
Thank you. Thank you to each of you for just telling us a little bit more about yourselves and your intellectual pursuits and interests. So Ron, this week's microsymposium of the Wayfinders is prompted by your reading of Richard Kearney. Can you start us off by reading a short extract from Kearney's writing? I'll be commenting on it as you go along.
Sure. So Gideon, when you approached me with this idea about doing a Google Hangout on the idea of identity, which is an important theme that's being explored with your wayfinding community, I kind of thought, well, I am in the middle right now of a 13-week seminar on the work of Richard Kearney, an Irish-born philosopher who now teaches in Lake Boston College. And whom I had interviewed for the other journal, simply because it's sort of, well, lazy on my part because I thought that's where my brain is already at, so I won't have to do a ton of prep, but also because for me, and Kearney's work has impressed this upon me even more, the question of one's own identity can never be asked in isolation or in a vacuum. And so we have to think about the way our different cultural inheritances shape our sense of identity and also our own responsibility in appropriating that and receiving that and doing something with it. And then in the same context, as we become more aware of pluralism and difference in our societies, the importance of imagination and the role that others play in shaping our identity, both the other that we sort of exclude and maybe monsterize and define ourselves against, but also maybe that zone of interaction where we can also learn something about a strangeness within ourselves. So I've picked a couple of passages from Kearney's book on stories to sort of read to get us started on this idea. And they're both from the sort of culminating chapter, I believe, called Narrative Matters. where Kearney starts to emphasize the idea that narrative or storytelling has a central role to play in our understanding of our identities. So I'll just start on on the top of page 129 for anybody who has the book on them, where Kearney says, and I quote, "Every human existence is a life in search of a narrative. This is not simply because it strives to discover a pattern to cope with the experience of chaos and confusion. It is also because each human life is always already an implicit story. Our very finitude constitutes us as beings who, to put it baldly, are born at the beginning and die at the end. And this gives a temporal structure to our lives which seeks some kind of significance in terms of referrals back to our past or memory and forward to our future or projection. So that we might say that our lives are constantly interpreting themselves, pre-reflectively and pre-consciously in terms of beginnings, middles, and ends, though not necessarily in that order. In short, our existence is already to some extent pre-plotted before we ever consciously seek out a narrative in which to reinscribe our life as a life history." So a lot of, we inherit our identity as a story we inherit, and then also we take up that story on our own, and we end up replotting our lives along as we go. And I think what's important to kind of keep in mind there then is that because our condition is finite temporal beings, that means it's impossible in principle for us to ever have the question of our own identities fully resolved. And that doesn't mean we completely lack identity or that we're basically schizophrenic beings, but that there's a certain fluidity within the continuity of our sense of identity and a certain openness and a certain ability for us to imagine other possibilities than simply the ones that have been given to us. And that's a journey that every human being is on in life. But the constancy and continuity we experience in a healthy sense of identity, I think, is an intersubjective accomplishment. We depend on our forebears for a cultural inheritance, but also the others in our lives tell stories about who we are through which we understand ourselves, but it's never just something done in isolation or in a vacuum. So Kearney talks about the importance of the relationship with, you know, the other in this sort of narrative journey of self-identity. And I just want to read one more, a little passage that's a little bit longer from page 139 and 140, where he ends up quoting from J.M. Coetzee. So Kearney says, and I quote, he's talking about the power of empathy. "This power of empathy with living things other than ourselves, the stranger the better, is a major test not just of poetic imagination but of ethical sensitivity. And in this regard, we might go so far as to say that genocides and atrocities presuppose a radical failure of narrative imagination. Jonathan Swift believed this, for instance, when he wrote A Modest Proposal with a view to securing understanding of the Irish famine in his English readers. And one of J.M. Coetzee's characters, Elizabeth Costello, applies similar arguments to the Holocaust. And here's a quote from that character. "The particular horror of camps, the horror that convinces us that what went on there was a crime against humanity, is not that despite a humanity shared with their victims, the killers treated them like lice. That is too abstract. The horror is that the killers refused to think themselves into the place of their victims, as did everyone else. They said it is they in those cattle cars rattling past. They did not say, how would it be if I were in that cattle car? They did not say, it is I who am in that cattle car. They said, it must be the dead who are being burnt today, making the air stink and falling in ash on my cabbages. They did not say, how would it be if I were burning? They did not say, I am burning, I am falling in ash." So Kearney goes on, in other words, concludes Elizabeth Costello, and he quotes from that character again, "They close their hearts. The heart is the seat of a faculty, sympathy, that allows us to share at times the being of another. There are people who have the capacity to imagine themselves as someone else. There are people who have no such capacity, and there are people who have the capacity but choose not to exercise it. There's no limit to the extent to which we can think ourselves into the being of another. There are no bounds to the sympathetic imagination." So then Kearney continues, and I'll just read a few more lines. He says, "If we possess narrative sympathy, enabling us to see the world from the other's point of view, we cannot kill. If we do not, we cannot love. We might say, consequently, that catharsis affords a singular mix of pity and fear, whereby we experience the suffering of other beings as if we were them. And it is precisely this double take of difference and identity, experiencing oneself as another and the other as oneself, that provokes a reversal of our natural attitude to things and opens us to novel ways of seeing and being. So, and that's what I wanted to read from On Stories to sort of help start us out today. But it's the two things, the idea that the search for human identity is a narrative journey of telling stories about ourselves with others, but also the idea that not any story will do, that we should be striving to tell stories that have a capable of ethical sensitivity toward others and that help us to become sympathetic and imagine our place, ourselves in the place of others and enlarge our sympathies. And if we want a just and caring world, that's the kind of issues we should be grappling with in our search for identity.
Wonderful to hear Kearney quote Jane Kutsia, a fellow South African. I was wondering, Ron, as you read Kearney, what becomes most significant for you personally? So how are you challenged as a person, as a scholar, but more than as a scholar, by what you read?
Right. Well, in many ways, but maybe I'll just focus on one. So, when I was in the seminar that I'm leading on Kearney, I have the students do, and I do myself, a style of presentation where we bring in whether art, cultural artifacts or things from the media or events going on today, and sort of talk about how Kearney's work helps kind of help us explain and explore what might be happening in those kinds of artifacts, or it could be news events or new developments. One of the chapters in On Stories talks about nations as narrations, so I thought I'd take the opportunity to talk about the traditional story Canada as a nation has told about itself, and you know, in terms of the founding fathers and you know, the building of the railway and the expansion of the West and all those sorts of things. And talk, you know, and it's, you know, quite interestingly talk about how others were imagined in those narratives. So of course we talked about the First Nations and Indigenous peoples in Canada, and the you know, the Indian Act and the legacy of exclusion and even cultural genocide, and the fact that, you know, we just finished a several year long process in Canada of truth and reconciliation that's still ongoing, where the stories of the victims of the residential schools have been told. And I found that just exposing myself to that process, going on the Truth and Reconciliation Commission website, listening to the narratives, the stories of other people. You know, I grew up in Western Canada in Edmonton with, you know, a lot of Native populations around in Edmonton, and but not having really any kind of familiarity or not knowing any, and sort of, Kearney's work, I guess, would help me see the importance of opening my identity up to that, thinking about the imagined community to which I belong and how it could be imagined otherwise. And, you know, I've actually, you know, in a very beginning way, and Jeffrey can probably talk a lot more about this than I can, but in a very sort of beginning way, I started to sort of more expose myself to that and seek out opportunities for that kind of engagement and enlargement of my imagination, and it's made me really question the dominant Canadian story of Canadian national identity, but also it's given me hope that we can start to tell a different story, the one that listens to the Indigenous voice more clearly, one that explores much more seriously our interconnectedness with each other through the land, to see the land as not a possession to be owned and grasped and exploited, but rather a gift to be shared. I mean, that affects things like the current refugee crisis in the world and Canada's efforts to welcome, you know, 25,000 Syrian refugees. So, you know, that's just the way I think Kearney's work kind of encourages us in that kind of direction. I think it's healthy. It's, you know, so, and it's a matter of exploring where you came from, what you thought your sense of identity was, and what challenges it, and how it might, you know, develop in different directions, more healthy directions, you know, and I really feel, you know, scripture calls us to this kind of journey as well, so that all fits together, but maybe I'll stop there.
I'm going to ask you one more question before I'm going to ask Jeff to respond to that from his perspective. you are, I'm guessing, the child of immigrants, or at most the grandchild of immigrants.
Right. Child of.
Yeah. So how does the immigrant experience figure as you think about identity, imagination, and the other within the North American or Canadian context?
Right. Yeah, so I'm a first-generation Canadian, and my parents were immigrants from the Netherlands, and they left at different times, but basically in the wake of World War II and the devastation that was sort of visited upon the Netherlands. My mom's family immigrated here quite soon after the war ended. My dad came a little later in the 50s, and they met in Canada. In terms of the way that shaped my identity, one of the things that I think is really big is that first-generation immigrant community can tend to be very reclusive and isolated and looking to each other for, comforts. They're in a strange country, new language. And the Dutch Reformed community is also very sort of culturally active, so they create all their own parallel organizations. You know, we had a Dutch Christian Reformed Hockey League so that kids could play hockey not on Sunday. our own version of Boy Scouts and Girl Guides, you know, all that kind of stuff. So if you grow up as in a first generation of that, you're in Canada, you speak English as your native tongue, and yet your social world is really confined to start with. And I think coming from that base and then sort of slowly through your teenage years and your coming of age years, really, really realizing how big a place the world is and how many different kinds of people there are and cultures and religions, music, a lot of the things that, you have a hunger to explore that, to break out of what seems to be kind of a constricted background. But it also gives you a really strong sense of identity and a secure place to branch out from. And I don't want to belittle that either, right? But for me in high school, getting involved in the kind of 1980s local DIY punk rock kind of movement in Canada and finding other teenagers in that, there was a real authentic search for, you know, meaning vis-a-vis what was going on politically at the time. It was, you know, the Reagan era, Reaganomics and all that kind of thing. And that sort of... I found that very sort of a saving force in my life, that kind of ability to question and explore things through that kind of counterculture. But I think that being a first generation child of immigrants that's sort of my story, but I think that might be a common one.
If I wonder, what are you thinking as you're listening to the conversation so far?
Well, I really appreciate hearing both the academic and the personal. I think they inform each other quite profoundly in this case. I think for me, I guess the first few thoughts around this sort of narration of nationality, it is something that has been very complicated in my own experience, you know, living as a Canadian citizen, the Canadian passport, having a father who was a first-generation immigrant to Canada from the UK. So according to UK law, I'm also a British citizen. And under the Indian Act, I'm a status Indian and a citizen of Fisher River Cree Nation, one of the five traditional First Nations in Winnipeg, a city that has had, you know, for 500 more years multiple sovereignties existing in a shared space. I think for myself, this idea of reconciliation is one that's deeply connected to encountering the stranger within, these sort of multiple versions of myself that I have obligation and role within, be that as a colonized or colonizer or as a other or one who's doing the othering, a subject or sometimes an object, you know, depending on how one is reading Canadian history. I think, you know, that question of how national identity is being constituted within this sort of reconciliation era, I think is deeply I think it can be deeply problematic and hopeful as well. I think there's a lot of creative opportunity for the way we narrate our relationship to create space that's generous, that's compassionate. I was reminded when the Kearney quote of Richard Wegemese, who's an Anishinaabe author from Manitoba. He writes that all that we are is story. From the moment we are born to the time that we continue on our spirit journey, we're involved in the creation of the story of our time here. It's what we arrive with. It's what we leave behind. We're not the things that we accumulate. We're not the things that we deem important. We are story, all of us. And what comes to matter is the creation of the best possible story we can narrate while we're here together. And when we can do that and share those stories with each other, we get bigger inside and we see each other and recognize our kinship. And I think kinship is really the means by which I come to understand my relationship to these many identities, that it's one of real deep, intimate relationship, and that's even different from being a neighbor, because I share some sort of more, almost blood-like relationship to these many identities. So that's some initial thoughts.
Great. So, Aya, as a non-Canadian, what do you hear and what do you think?
So, I know that many of my friends in New York, being a very liberal city, to say the least, often they express an envy of what's going on politically in Canada right now. In very broad, you know, things are just so much better up there. Maybe we should move north, especially with just the there are tons of poisonous discourses going around the U.S. political scene right now, both in the media and then on social media, especially. There are days when I have to just take a break from Facebook because it's just so, people are just constantly yelling over each other. And I think what a lot of this is bringing to mind is just the importance of listening and hearing each other's stories, giving each other space to tell each other's stories. I think one of the things that I brought up in our former Twitter chat was this idea of being a Japanese American. So all of us come from immigrant parents, it seems. My parents came to the U.S. First to Texas and then moved up to Virginia in the 70s and then mid-80s. And I never felt really Japanese. My dad is from a small town called Nagiso, and my mother's from Osaka, and they both came to the U.S. to pursue graduate degrees. And so moving into first the Deep South, and then still Virginia is technically the Bible Belt of sorts. But I grew up very privileged, but also very divorced from any sense of being Japanese, outside of the fact that my dad tried to teach me in the car on the way to school, and I would shut him down, saying, "No, Daddy, I'm Japanese. I'm American." So my sense of coming to terms with being a Japanese American happened in college when I started doing a project on taiko drumming, which is a distinctly, really a Japanese American phenomenon, because many people in the wake of World War II came over to the States. And then especially with the American occupation of Japan, as well as the changes post the internment camps in California out west, people were searching for an identity, and they were searching for something authentic. And the taiko drums and the performativity, the athleticism of it, really spoke to people. And so now pretty much anywhere you have a strong Japanese community, you'll likely find a taiko troupe as well. So that got me thinking. And it was in the process of doing that research project that I first learned about the Japanese-American internment camps. It had never been brought up in my history courses in middle school or high school or anything like that. And I think the story of the people who survived from those camps provides a very interesting parallel to what's going on right now with a very strong Islamophobia So recently I had the opportunity to see a good friend of mine be in the cast of Allegiance, which was the George Takei musical about the Japanese-American internment experience. And it was a notable musical for many reasons, because it was really the first thing since Miss Saigon that there's been a largely Asian cast on stage. And then it was telling a previously untold story. Mm-hmm. And while it didn't, it closed just 2 weeks ago. But as it was on stage, it was right concurrent with several politicians coming out and saying, hey, you know what, I probably would have supported FDR's executive order to push these people into the camps. And so it was just, I don't know, you really sense the parallels of history and mm-hmm. both the idea that we can either listen to history or we can choose to ignore it. There's that space to imagine better and to imagine worse. And what will we learn? What will we do? And I think we're still very much trying to figure that out right now in the U.S. Right now, it seems like we're imagining a lot worse. But, you know, we'll see.
I'm intrigued. When you talk about your own discovery of the Japanese-American experience with internment in World War II, you hint that deepens your own capacity to imagine the experience of people subjected to Islamophobia in America now. That resonates for me with what Ron had read from Kearney, specifically Kearney quoting from Jane Castell. I wonder if you can just speak a little bit more about how the narrative of your own closer ethnic community allows for your imagination to open you up to the experience of people from different communities.
So I feel that I'm at a very interesting point because my parents are not of the initial generation that immigrated to the U.S. and that underwent that experience. And so that was very much not part of my family's narrative, but I'm finding more and more that it's actually part of my ethnic heritage, if you would have it. And it's something I'm still working on interpolating into my own life. But seeing... I had read accounts of how bad the camps were, and I had experienced, at least for my college brain, enormous amounts of empathy then. And also having experienced the power of taiko drumming myself and performing with a troupe down in North Carolina, how that would work to heal in some ways, to empower. And I think once I saw Allegiance and I saw it musicalized, I saw it actually enacted out. I'm very much a person that if you sing to me, I get you better, you know. So I can't go to straight plays very often, is because I'm wondering why they're not singing. But I think in light of that artistic experience, as well as the narrative that I became familiar with in college, to know that Muslims in America could go through the same thing at the hands of people who refuse to be empathetic, it breaks my heart, you know. You know, we are all brought up in America on this idea of the American dream. Whether or not that is really a reality or not, and I think it's a reality for some. I think largely it's a myth. I think we all need that as a source of optimism. And when different people groups try to enforce their own right to that narrative but deny it to other people is very problematic. So I don't know if I answered your question.
that was cool, but it allowed me to segue because I'm intrigued by your saying that you need to hear people sing to have a sense of who they are. And so I want to ask Ron and Jeff, what are the songs that mattered most to you as you tried to figure out who you are? And I'll come back to you with the same question. You can just sort of weave in with each other.
That's not a hard question at all.
Well, one song jumped into my mind right away. Actually, two songs. One is 40 by U2. I was 8 years old the first time I went to a U2 concert, which is, I think, pretty remarkable. And that song was sung, and it's always stuck with me for years, but I think that song is, it's a lament. This sort of prophetic posture of waiting and protesting and lamenting and hoping and having hopes decimated, all those sorts of complexities, I think, lamenting as part of who I am, that makes me sound kind of depressing. But, you know, I think about my mother's generation who were a part of the 1960s scoop in Canada, or my grandmother's generation, my grandmother, a residential school survivor, and the importance of hearing their story and encountering the reality of their lived experience has been one of listening to suffering, listening to lament and protest. The other song for me was actually... that came into my head was it's called Love Song for Attawapiskat, and it's written by Leanne Simpson, an Ojibwe scholar, and it's essentially a spoken word overlaid with traditional Anishinaabe singing, and in it she critiques the Canadian government for the ongoing oppression of Attawapiskat, which is a northern rural community that's lacked clean water, lacked education systems, and whose chief protested in a hunger strike in front of Parliament in 2012. So for me, that song, I think, again, it's a narration, but it's also from a very distinct tradition. You know, 40 comes from the Hebrew Bible, and this love song for Attawapiskat comes from Ojibwe culture, and I think that in many ways they both bear imprints of the way I imagine the world, waiting for some, you know, in 40, waiting for, you know, this sort of redeemer, this savior, and in Love Song for Attawapiskat, waiting for humans to act rightly, which I think for me reflects both, I think, my hope and what I sort of see as my lived reality.
Well, it's going to be hard to follow that. And you caught me a little bit off guard because, you know, I'm trying to put myself really back into when I first awakened to the fact that sort of music and art could be a way of... you know, awakening you to existential themes, social and political themes, and of exploring them in meaningful ways. And it's interesting that Jeffrey mentioned 40 from you too, because I think it was that record, the war record, when my older sister's boyfriend brought that into our house when I had been listening to just, you know, top 20 radio. I was, I don't know, I was in the early 80s when that record came out, so I was like, 13, 14 years old. And kind of thinking, oh, music can be like this. Like, it can matter. It can, you know, if you listen to Bono's way of singing, it's just so raw and kind of bleeding and on that record. So that was one record that was really a turning point for me when I thought, wow, you know, he's talking about what's going on in Ireland and how he as an Irish citizen is, you know, responding to that, and, you know, in songs like Sunday Bloody Sunday, New Year's Day. So, I mean, I would have to mention something like that too. The other record that my brother-in-law brought into the house was The Clash's London Calling, and there's a song on there called The Clamptown. And it's kind of about a working-class British town where you're just expected to go into the local mine and have capitalism use up your body, and that's that, right? And the song has an imaginative kind of exploration of, like, you don't have to. That's not your life story. You don't have to do that. You don't have to go down that road that's been prepared for you. You don't have to work for the clampdown, right? So these are kinds of awakening songs, I guess. Those are just two that jumped into my head, but, I mean, there's quite a bit more. The thing with in the United States and Canada that punk rock singing in the 80s was a sense of music can be liberated from the corporate structures that package it and sell it, and that was quite a discovery. There's a really good book by a guy named Michael Azarad called Our Band Could Be Your Life, which is a line from a Minutemen song, and it just explores the 80s, all these bands who sort of, you know, as Henry Rollins would say, just got in the van, made their own little tapes, did all their own artwork, did everything, distributed all their own recordings and toured all independently without any, you know, financial help from major labels. And you have this whole decade of this happening in the 80s to the point where the industry sits up and takes notice. And it really helps explain why something like Nirvana happened in the early 90s, the way it blew up like that. Because a lot of the groundwork for that kind of music that was quite a bit different had already been prepared. That's a bit of a, you know, I guess the point I'm making there is that even in your very interaction with whatever art, if, you know, we're talking here more about popular forms of culture, but you know, the freedom of our imagination to wrest itself free from certain destructive power structures is there. It's always available, and I think that's something that gives me hope.
Mm-hmm. Hiya, songs. Do you want to say anything?
So, I'll avoid singing, but I think in line with this thread, you know, my introduction to the pop music scene was really the Backstreet Boys, so it's a lot less serious than the punk rock scene or anything like that, and not political in the slightest, but I think the song that I keep coming back to, and on any given day you'll find me singing something else, just depending on my mood. But in terms of meaning, I think that Firefly song that I mentioned at the very beginning has had, I've revisited it over and over and over again in several conference papers, and I'll probably come back to it in my dissertation, because it took that tiny little theme song and it spun out all of the themes that were important in the show. Yes, it was a sci-fi dystopic television show, but ultimately what it came down to were these themes of family, and specifically found family, meaning the community that you find that is not your blood family, necessarily. Finding community there, and then also going through life together, and doing that process of narrative construction and self-analysis through the stories and through the different moments of trial. So I find that very interesting. I think, going on this punk rock thing, though, instantly, the wizard rock movement that I'm spending a couple chapters on is actually a direct offshoot of all of these processes put into place by the punk rock movement. And they are... I don't want to say apolitical, but they started off, everybody will tell you in the movement that it started off as a joke. They're like, we wanted to write some silly songs about Harry Potter, and we just did it in our garage. And so a lot of these guys are influenced by bands like Nirvana, Fugazi, and did all of their own distribution, did all of their own recording, got it out there, and then with it overlapping with the explosion of MySpace, was able to really do this... the millennial version of a DIY movement. Mm. Where was I going with this? I just think that Nowadays, the Wizard Rock movement works very much in alignment with this organization called the Harry Potter Alliance, which is a nonprofit that attempts to do, they do a model called the Narrative Leadership Model. And so they draw inspiration from fictional characters like Harry Potter, like Katniss Everdeen from The Hunger Games, like Luke Skywalker from Star Wars. And they try to take their stories and work them and use them as a source of inspiration for social justice causes. Do they do it perfectly? No, not in the slightest. But they are trying to imagine better, which I think is one of the great things and the power of fiction, of popular fiction, of pop culture, to bring about change, to bring about positive change. Mm. So,
I wish we could keep talking all day, but we have about 5 minutes left to conclude. And so I want to ask each of you, and I, Jeff, in a sentence or two, what is the most significant question that you are taking away from our conversation today? We'll be teasing out the questions that you raise now in our Twitter chat at WeChat tomorrow and Wednesday, and then with that one on Thursday. So I'm going to keep talking for another sentence or two as you formulate these questions, and then as you're ready, just tell us, you know, what is the question you want to continue exploring out of today's conversation. As you think about that, I really appreciate the conversation about Psalms. There's just so much that came to mind about that. I have to do my own testimony. I think I would have been about 12, early 1980s, and in the South African setting, hearing the first U2 songs was an incredibly powerful the sense of liberation, the sense of the possibility of a celebratory song nonetheless inviting us into lament, and that lament inviting us into personal change and action. It's a profound encounter. But then, of course, there was Zulu rock with bands like Deluca that did that indigenous way in South Africa, hybrid indigenous, but indigenous way in South Africa. So, your questions.
Who do you want to go first? I'll go first. I think the big thing I'm going to take away is the importance of listening in one's search for identity. If we're going to be serious about stopping practices of destructive othering in establishing our sense of identity and having a narrative imagination that's ethically sensitive, the listening part of, to me, that I emphasize is really important. Another song that I was thinking of that is a really, really profound lament. It's a band from, I think they're from Arizona or New Mexico. They're called Calexico, but they have a song from an album called Garden and Ruin called Cruel, and it's sort of lamenting the state of the environment. But one of the lines is that, they say, stories break like branches in the cold. And I think they're lamenting a culture that's been so frozen over that we're not hearing each other's stories, and they're being iced over, and they're just breaking and falling to the ground. And I think we can, if we can become better listeners, then we can start to reverse that kind of thing, and hopefully that would, you know, make the world a better place to be.
Mm-hmm. I'll go. I think for me, I'm curious as to, I think all of us are constantly in this process of analyzing our narratives, and I think as scholars, more than ever, we're constantly self-analyzing. But I'm kind of curious as to what are the moments that stop us in our tracks and force us to look back and start to reinterpret our narratives thus far. What are those defining moments, I guess?
You know, Ron, you were talking about Kearney earlier, and you referred to the sort of inability of being able to resolve our identity and sort of calling us towards a fluidity and openness. I think one of the questions I have working in community organizing or restorative justice work within relationships between, you know, different sort of dyads, be it Canadian and Indigenous or other. How to practice with individuals whose identity, who have foreclosed on the question of identity and its fluidity, who see it as something resolved. And I think that, you know, that happens in, you know, many sides of equations. But what are the practices that compel others in our work and in our vocation towards a more reflective posture and openness to deal with the inresolvability of identity?
Well, thank you, Aya and Jeff and Ron, for the gift of your time and invitation to one another, the gift of conversation with one another. Thank you, Ron, for prompting today's conversation with your reading of Kearney, and I look forward to continuing the conversation on Twitter tomorrow. So anyone who's watching this live or watching the broadcast, if you catch us in time, I will be back tomorrow at noon Eastern time on Twitter. You can look for the hashtag WayChat, so hashtag WayChat, or you can look at the Twitter account that we use to prompt these conversations at ICS Wayfinders. Thank you all of you, and I look forward to the continuation of this conversation.